سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Dear honorable, respected, beloved brothers and fathers, beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, dear honorable youth, أحييكم جميعا, I greet you over the universal greetings of love, peace and mercy. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله, we begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Peace and salutations be upon our dear beloved Habib al-Mustafa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa nas'alu Allah al-Azim Rabb al-Arsh al-Kareem, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alladhi jama'ana fi hadha al-majlis, the one who has gathered all of us once again today in the house of Allah together ala ta'ati, together upon the obedience of Allah. May Allah continue to gather us like this in the dunya. Ameen. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so decrees that our time in this dunya comes to an end, may Allah gather us like this in the company of Habib al-Mustafa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We remember all those who have passed on, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah Rabbul Izzah grant them all Jannatul Firdaus al-A'la. We remember all those who are ill, and we ask Allah, Allah grant them all complete shifa. Ameen. Likewise, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that all those from amongst us within our community and beyond, whose hearts are filled with du'as and supplications, and they find themselves in situations of need, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to the aid. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Jama'atul Muslimin, when we talk about time in the life of a Muslim, we need to understand as Muslims that time is something very, very valuable that has been gifted to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, time is so precious that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named a surah in the Quran of the time. Time is so precious in the life of every human being and Muslim specifically that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a qasam, took a sunbah, took an oath by time. Because time in the life of every single human being, but even more specifically a Muslim, is something that a Muslim needs to cherish every split second of their lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among those who cherish every minute gifted to us by Allah. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. But the question that we start our Jum'ah khutbah nasiha today with: what and who has the most right over my time? What and who has the most right over my time that Allah has gifted me as a human being, as a Muslim, as a mu'min, as a husband, as a wife, as a mother, as a father, as a student, as an employer, as an employee? Who has the ultimate right over my time as a human being in the sight of Allah? That's the question that we start our Jum'ah nasiha with today. Who and what has the most right over the time it was gifted to me by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Jama'atul Muslimin, the answer to this question, it might sound very simple, but most of the time it is the most difficult thing for human beings to apply in their lives. The one who has the most right over my time as a Muslim, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that sounds simple, let me break it down. We spend 8 hours at work. We spend 10 hours in our homes. That's how many hours? 18, 19, 20. So we've got another 6 hours. And then we spend 3 hours on the road driving bread, milk, vehicle, whatever it might be. Right? So you've got 3 hours left. And then you have 3 hours you probably spend sleeping. How much of that minutes of that day have we spent in the path of Allah? When the boss says, I want you here at 8 o'clock, no matter how fa'irkhlat we are there at 8 o'clock. When Allah says, I want you here when the adhan is done for Maghrib, we can drive past. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when people gather in my house, they spend time and they study the Quran and they get to know Allah and they remember Allah, and the angels surround him and the mercy of Allah
statements, are we those who still find themselves stingy enough to not want to even give 20 minutes of my week to the house of Allah? And wallahi, unfortunately, this is becoming a sickness and a disease within our communities, not only the community of Baha. You know, mashallah, one of the beautiful things you learn in Makkah and Medina, may Allah grant all of the mu'tamirin umrah maqbool, ameen. One of the beautiful things you learn in Makkah and Medina, life revolves around salah. Like, salah first, then ramadan. Salah first, then eat. Salah first, then shopping. Salah first, then. Salah, then. And then you find people, they come back from Makkah and Medina, say, Ya Allah, it was so gemakkelijk geweest for me, om salah altijd te maken in Makkah and Medina. It's so zwaar geweest. It was so easy for me to live a righteous life in Makkah and Medina. And so gevaarlijk zwaar, just to live a righteous life in my own house at home, where I grew up with my parents, gave birth to me, subhanAllah. Do you know what's the difference? When you were there, you gave more time to Allah. And you gave less time to the dunya. And that in itself has an amazing reward from Allah, which we will hear about very soon, inshallah. So the question that we ask, Jama'at Muslim, who and what has the most right over our time that has been given to us by Allah? Without a doubt, it is Allah. I said that the answer might sound very simple to many. Many might go home and they go to Jama'at and say, hey, my brother, ABC question of Allah. Inshallah, no problem. Come tomorrow morning, Fajr. Come tomorrow morning, Fajr, to the masjid. Come, Fajr. Then everyone was in Jum'ah today. Come and see if you see all the familiar faces here tomorrow morning for Jum'ah. I'm from Fajr. Illa man rahim Allah, except those who are asked by a very valuable reason to not be in the masjid. I was once at Masjid Quba. I went four times to Masjid Quba on this trip now. And I, one of those four times I was standing in Masjid Quba, and one of the foreign nationals asked me a question, and they said, Sheikh, what is the hukum for men? Where must they salah? And I said, wow, what a good question. I said, let's go back to the time of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ja'a rajulun a'ma ila al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A blind man comes to the Nabi of Allah and he says, Ya Rasulallah, I've got a valid reason why I cannot come for Fajr to the masjid. I don't have eyesight. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, for as long as you've got brothers that live next to you that is coming to the masjid, you don't have an excuse valid in the sight of Allah. You do not have an excuse valid in the sight of Allah to make that same salah. Remember, this person wasn't asking, can you come in the haste? Like, oh Nabi, he can be less of salah at home. No, he said, Ya Rasulullah, can I make salah at home? Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam valued this question through the lens, how much of your time are you giving to Allah? This was how he viewed the question. How much of your energy are you giving to Allah? How much of your eyesight are you giving to Allah? We, alhamdulillah, our eyesight functions 24 hours a day. If 23 hours of that day I am using my eyes to read statements, to do work, to read people's messages on my phone, to watch TV, and I spend a half an hour of that 24 hours of the day looking in the Quran, then there's a problem. If I spend half an hour out of 24 hours of the day looking at my musalla, looking at the masjid, looking at the mimbar, looking at the mihrab, then there is a problem, Jama'at Muslim. Because al-awla, the one who has the most right over our time is Allah. And so we ought to be giving the most of ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jama'at Muslim, this brings us to the next question. How do I know if I am someone who gives most of his time to Allah? How do I know if I am someone who makes who gives Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala priority over my time? How do I know if I am amongst these people? Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, be beautifully explains to us. Likewise, the Sahaba and the ulama and the Salihin, and they say, إِذَا أَصْبَحَ الْعَبْدُ with a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wakes up in the morning, وَأَمْسَى or he goes to sleep at night, وَهَمُّهُ and his main concern and his goal and what bothers him the most is Allah, then that is a person who gave most of his aid to Allah. How do I know if I am someone who's giving most of my time and my day to Allah? At night when I go and sleep, what I think the most about is not how many times did I not answer that person's phone call, how many times did I perhaps delay a response to that one, did I delay a response to Allah today? When the adhan call for salah, did I delay a response? You know, mashallah, my conversation with this brother went further in the Jum'ah, who were at Afwan at Masjid Quba, and I answered him by saying the following. What does the Mu'addin say when it is time for Salah? Does he say go to Salah or does he say come to Salah? Has anyone reflected on the Adhan before? What does the Mu'addin say? Does he say, Idhab ila Salah, Khabak Salah, Ya Shumada, Ya Kama, Ya Mar Shumada, Idhab ila Salah, or does he say, Hayya ala Salah? What does the Mu'addin say? The Mu'addin says, Hayya ala Salah. Come to Salah. Where is the Mu'addin? The Mu'addin is calling you to come to where he is. Where is the Mu'addin? In the house of Allah. So every time I am sitting in my house on a couch in a mall, in my car, without a valid reason, and I hear the Adhan go, Hayya ala Salah, and I do not respond to that call physically and mentally, then I have chosen other than Allah, Allah. And this is the most beautiful lesson that we take from Mecca and Medina. When the Adhan goes, you can be standing in the line waiting for your food, that guy close the gate in front of you. Could I want? Come after the Salah. And you know what's so amazing? I stood one day in the line with 20 South Africans in front of me, waiting for the same food. When they close the gate, you might go out there. You close the gate, get down. You're a khot. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. You close that same gate. In fact, you don't even close the gate. When you didn't get down here, it's wait more than 20 minutes for an ordered meal. But just around your salat and janazah dua. It's done. It's done. But when you go to Makkah and Medina, you stand. Passive, you contend, must I come off Salah? No, you know why? Because everyone goes to Salah. Everyone understands the value. Allah first, everything else last. And wallahi, there are benefits in these type of responses. There are benefits for myself and yourself, for our children, for our house, for our community. Wallahi, every time that we decide to give more of our time to Allah, there is grand benefits that comes from it. Listen to what the ulama and the scholars they say. إِذَا أَصْبَحَ الْعَبْدُ وَأَمْسَى وَلَيْسَ هَمُّهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ. When a person wakes up in the morning or he goes to sleep at night and his only focus is Allah. His only focus is the dunya. His only focus is Allah, the Rasul and the dunya, the Quran and the Sunnah. Listen to the reward from Allah. تَحَمَّلُ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى حَوَائِجَهُ Every matter and concern that you have in your heart, every dua, everything that you've been wanting to give your children, your husband, your wife, every success that you've been looking for in your business, when you make the akhirah your concern, Allah takes care of the dunya. When you make Allah, when you make the akhirah your concern, Allah takes care of your dunya. Then he carries on and he says, subhanAllah, listen to what he says. He says, وَإِنْ أَصْبَحَ وَأَمْسَى وَالدُّنْيَا هَمُّهُ. And when this person, a Muslim, male or female, when they wake up in the morning and they go and sleep at night, and the ultimate concern is, وَخِيَرَةِ مُورَمَاكَ. Hoeveel geld heb ik vandaag gemaakt? I wonder what did my children achieve? Dunya today. What's my children going to achieve? Dunya tomorrow. When your focus is dunya. takes the dunya and the akhirah away from you. Allah takes dunya and akhirah away from you. So the ulama, the scholars, they say, الانشغال بالله عز وجل, making sure that you are constantly occupied with the thought of Allah, remembering Allah, staying conscious of Allah, giving most of your time to Allah. If this is your response, Allah will take care of every aspect of your dunya. How many times do we see with our parents, they raise children, but they don't know, do I go left or do I go right? Parents, ya Allah, we're living in a very challenging time today where people are losing their jobs, losing their houses. The electricity just went up by 18.5%. My brothers and sisters, the world is becoming tougher. And if not everybody feels that, because those who are above certain brackets are not feeling the pinch, well, there's going to come a time where all of us are going to feel the pinch. Whether it's not now, it's going to happen. How do I ensure that whatever goals I have set for myself in the dunya, whatever plans I have for myself and my family in the dunya, how do I ensure that I will make a success of it? Wallahi, respond to the call of Allah daily. Give the best of yourself to Allah. Give the most of your time to Allah. And Allah will give you the best in dunya and akhirah. Jama'atul Muslimin, this is without any judgment to anyone seated in this masjid. This is an address to the entire world, not to the people of Bara only. For as long as our fajrs are still quarter soft, half soft, one soft, two soft, and I can say this very happily, because I'm not here for fajr, so nobody can say she knows. Right? Or Sheikh is judging, Sheikh didn't even see me do Fajr. No, no, I didn't see anyone do Fajr. Because I wasn't here. But for as long as our Fajr walks in the masjid is filled with more excuses than people, then the victim that this ummah is looking for will be filled with more excuses than actually people. For as long as we are not, or we find ourselves in a space where we are not responding to the call of Allah, giving more of ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you know there are still young people, the younger parents that are here today in the masjid? We still find that there are parents making excuses for why their children cannot go to madrasa. Do we know that? Has it taken the shift? There's no time. Well, if we do not occupy our children's time with Allah, then our children will occupy their time with the dunya. And if our children occupies more of their time with the dunya, do not expect much from your children in relation to the akhirah. That's the reality. My parents sacrificed 14 years. 14 years of being away from both their children. Both of them. Today, as a parent, I take that as my greatest inspiration not to make excuses for my children why they cannot find time to study the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I am not saying that we need to, and I say this at a very pivotal time within the year of all of us, because right now we have students preparing for a new grade. We have employers and employees realigning their goals, financial goals, dunya goals for the year. May Allah bless our goals, ameen. May Allah bless our children with success, ameen. The question I'm asking you today, give your children the dunya haq, but do not allow yourself as a parent to deprive your children from the akhirah. Do not allow ourselves to deprive ourselves from giving ourselves our akhirah. MashaAllah, Bara is a very, 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 very big community, mashaAllah. Allah bless everyone that lives in Bara and here. But for as long as a Maghrib doesn't look like this, I cannot claim as an Imam that we have succeeded. We have not. For as long as a Maghrib does not look like this, then as an Imam I still need to work harder. I need to put more time in. I need to put more effort in. But Jama'atul Muslimin, do not forget that the final step begins with every one of us at the drop of our own door. Let this be the year, I mean, inshallah, when we make the niyyah to try. If last year we gave a half an hour to Allah, make niyyah to give 2 hours of your day this year. Because the more we give to Allah, the greater we will receive from Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Ameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the benefit of being connected with Allah, occupying ourselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, allow me to end with this ayah. For those who might be thinking, Sheikh, no, why? Sheikh, no, get the topic of great. Sheikh, it's not your boring. No problem. Bismillah ar-Rahman. ومن يعش عن ذكر الرحمن نقيض له شيطانا فهو له قليل. Allah says, those who forget about me, those who choose the dunya over me, those who choose their own lives over the lives I have chosen for them, let them know, نقيض له شيطانا. Shaitan is going to get a solid grip over them. And once Shaitan gets a solid grip over you, Allah says, the dunya, irrespective of how vast it is, it's going to become so narrow in your eyesight that you are going to become uncomfortable living in this dunya. So for all of us who are seated today in this masjid, if we want the dunya to feel peaceful around us, we want our homes to feel peaceful, we want our families to be peaceful, we want our children to be peaceful, we want our marriages to be peaceful, we want our own lives to be peaceful, then give more of your time to Allah. Because the more of your time that you give to Allah, the wider Allah makes the dunya for you. The more barakah Allah places in your rizq. The more sabr Allah places in your marriage. The more obedience Allah places in the hearts of your children. Jamaat al-Muslimin. The key to every father that came in the time of the Sahaba compared to now. The difference is the key. Whenever the Nabi spoke, they jumped. And so what happened? When the fathers left, the children jumped even higher. Anyone heard of Sayyidina Umar? Sayyidina Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu. He had a son. Do you know what his son's name? Do you know what his son's name? When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu left this dunya, his son became instrumental behind the build of every single masjid in Medina. You know why? Because his father said that. When the call was made, his father was there. Jamaat al-Muslimin, at this masjid, we've got loads of classes happening, alhamdulillah. We have Thursday evening dhikrs. Inshallah, we will be shortly introducing the Shafi'i Anam on a Friday, Jumu'ah evening, inshallah, bithillah. Jamaat al-Muslimin, at least one evening for the week, let us try and take out some of our time to be in the house of Allah with the whole family. And inshallah, they say a family that prays together stays together. But wallahi, I feel that a family that comes to masjid together will have the best of the dunya and the akhirah together. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jamaat al-Muslimin, just a few announcements, or at least one for today, inshallah. As we are moving forward, we all know that we are about 2 Jum'ahs to 3 Jum'ahs away from the blessed month of Rajab. And then inshallah we move into Sha'ban. And Allahumma ameen, and we reach the blessed month of Ramadan. Inshallah we've got loads of programs that are planned that will be taking place at this masjid, inshallah. The updates will be coming out very soon. We hope and we pray that many of our community, the Musallis, the mothers and daughters, and whoever else. You know, it was so beautiful thing for me when I pulled up at the masjid now. I saw so many females coming to the masjid. I said, Ya Allah, shukra wa Allah. Because when we have our mothers with us in the masjid, when we have our daughters with us in the masjid, then we are busy building a very bright future. Because when our mothers are in the same masjid like us and they're making dua with us and they say Ameen, they are saying Ameen whilst they are standing on Jannah. Al Jannah tahta aqdam al ummahat. Wallahi, I will say it again, a masjid grows in power when the musallis of that community grows with the presence in the masjid. And I hope and pray, inshallah, that this will be a very powerful year for this masjid, ameen, where our attendance will grow, multiply by tenfold, ameen, inshallah. And to all of our mothers and our sisters and our daughters that are here today for Jum'ah, I would love to say a very personal shukran to them for taking out of their time, for coming to the masjid. Wallahi, it brought joy to my heart when I saw them into the masjid. May Allah bless our mothers, ameen. Allah reward them greatly. Allah bless our daughters. Allah bless our wives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us relationships in our community that will grow from strength to strength. Ameen. Rabbil Alameen. Jama'at al-Muslimin, the dhikr started this past Thursday last night. I understand some people, their bones needed some greasement, so they couldn't make it to the masjid. But inshallah, hopefully next week, there will be more ameen, inshallah. Ameen. Rabbil Alameen. And inshallah, I don't know if this will be an inspiration, but there will also be free zamzam next week. Free, inshallah. So if you want to purchase zamzam, come next week Thursday to the masjid, inshallah. We have Allah, Allah grant us acceptance, ameen. We also have many, if not most of our mu'tamireen who have traveled from within our community are back again. I see the brother over there is also back, mashallah, he and his sister, Allah grant him umrah maqbool, ameen. But Jama'at Muslimin, we've got lots of programs coming up. We hope and pray that we will have the support and the backup of our community, ameen, inshallah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad.